Good morning. Good to see everyone here this morning. Come on in and get settled. I'll go over a couple of announcements we have. There's a deacon's meeting today at 12:30, so if you're a deacon, it's going to be your last heads up about that meeting. Worship committee and session that you'll meet tomorrow night, worship committee at 6:30 and session at 7:30. And then want everybody to make sure that they know about the joint service at Relay, the Thanksgiving service that'll be coming up. And we have decided to move that till Tuesday before Thanksgiving because Wednesday and Thanksgiving Day is going to be so busy for folks. So that'll be Tuesday, November 21st at 7:30, and we'll be at Relay. And then Swiss, always during the holidays, need help with the food. So the annual giveaway will be coming up soon as well. So if you're shopping at the toy department, please keep Swiss in mind. And if you can't take your contribution directly to a drop-off at the Methodist Church, just bring it here. And adult Sunday school, as always, Naomi leads a very nice Sunday school at 9:45. We'll finish up Ecclesiastes, and we'll roll right into Advent. So we have a couple more weeks on Ecclesiastes. Anyone else have any announcements? All right. Well, as we have been doing of late, I will say, this is the day the Lord has made, and you all respond with,
let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Amen. And may the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Peace be with you. How are you? Good morning.
Good morning.
We'll begin with the call to worship. Thanks be to you, O God, that we have risen this day
to the rising of this life itself.
Be the purpose of God between us and each purpose.
The hand of God between us and each hand.
The pain of Christ between us and each pain.
The love of Christ between us and each love.
O God, who brought us to the bright light of this new day,
bring us to the guiding light of eternity.
We'll now sing the first hymn, Now Thank We All Our God. Let us pray. Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor everyone. Love and serve the Lord. Rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. We'll continue with a prayer of confession. Women and men, as God intended, daughters of Adam, sons of Eve, children of earth, loved by their Maker, those only heaven could conceive. Yet in our loving, we are not one with heaven's deep intent. We are not as God meant. Ours is the shame, ours is the story, ours is a squandered legacy. Fallen from grace, In Christ we are saved. Through Christ we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Praise him with castanets and dance. Praise him with banjo and flute. Praise him with cymbals and a big bass drum. Praise him with fiddles and mandolin. Let every living, breathing creature praise God. Hallelujah. Here ends our lesson.
Second scripture lesson comes from the book of John this morning, and I ask that you let this scripture reading be the backdrop against which the sermon happens. It's not going to be an interpretation of the scripture, but this is a story I know everyone's. And so just hold it in the back of your mind, and what will follow will be against that backdrop. Does that make sense? Lots of ways to use scripture. Like I said, I know you all know this story. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concern is that to you and me? My hour has not yet come. His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now standing there were six stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. And Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. And when the steward tasted the water that had become wine and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk." That's a little tip for your parties. "But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs, in Cana of Galilee, and revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. And after this, he went down to Capernaum with his mother, his brothers, and his disciples, and they remained there for a few days. All right, we're going to have a little fun this morning. I have yet to find in the rule books about church that you can't have fun. But before we can have fun, I've got to ask you to do something that you're not going to like. And I know this, but I can't get around it. What I want is for everybody to get up and move to the front four pews. And I know that's the worst thing a preacher can ask you to do. But please, everybody come up.
So in order to understand my experience with Appalachia and being from the mountains, you have to understand my dad. So I need to tell you just a little bit about him. He grew up in Halifax County, Virginia, which is south side of Virginia, down below Richmond. And it wasn't until after World War II that he and his brothers came to my hometown of Woodville, Virginia, which is about 80 miles southwest of Roanoke, Virginia. So it's up in the mountains, a small town up in the mountains. And Dad, not having been from the mountains, he just fell in love with everything to do with the Appalachian culture, and especially the people themselves. He just loved it, thought they were the salt of the earth, and wanted to make sure, since I had the great privilege of being born there, he wanted to make sure that I grew up with an appreciation of Appalachian traditions, and especially those old mountain people that were carrying a lot of things forward that went back, you know, a couple of hundred years from when their ancestors had come over from Scotland, not Ireland. So deep history and heritage and all of that. So Dad was very, very determined to teach me as much as he could about the old mountain ways of doing things. And primarily because he was a banjo player too. He had learned banjo as a kid. So he kind of fit in the right way. But he taught me banjo and then taught me other things, would take me out on the weekends and introduce me to interesting mountain characters. And so when I was about 16, I came home from high school and Dad was home from work, which was unusual. And he had this big grin on his face and a twinkle in his eye. And he said, "You know, I've been trying to teach you about your mountain heritage. But there's one fundamental part of our mountain heritage that we haven't even touched on at all, and that is making moonshine. So we have to make some moonshine." And I'm like, you know, what 16-year-old kid has a dad come to them and say, "We're going to run some illegal white corn there," okay? And so I was like, "Oh, man, this is the coolest thing that could have happened." And you know, that's everything a teenager would want in this blood permission from your father to do it. So he didn't know anything more about making moonshine than I did. So he found this old bootlegger, and this guy who made and sold moonshine for a living. And he got instructions from the bootlegger on how to make the mash, which is what you put in the still, and got a recipe for that. And he also got this little, which he gave to me. This was great. I mean, I was in heaven. This little 10-gallon still. I mean, I had my own still. And it was a working still. It stood about this high, had a little copper coil coming out of the top of it. It was great. A little personal still. And so we had everything. We got an old crock and put the mash in that. And it takes about 2 or 3 weeks for the mash to ferment. And it's fundamentally rotting corn. So after a couple of weeks of this in the house, you can barely, it smells so bad. You could barely stand in the house. But we stuck it out. Because the windows open a lot. It's summertime, I guess. And so finally the day came that we called the old moonshiner and said, "The mash is ready." And Dad had already taken the still. And he said, "The mash is ready. Can you come out and make it?" It was on Saturday. He said, "Absolutely." He said, "Come on." He said, we'll run it tonight. And so Dad and I put that old crock of mash in the car, rolled all the windows down, and took off out of town. And for a ways, we were on lined, paved roads, just county roads. And then it just turned to just plain old country blacktop. And then we took a turn off onto this gravel road. It was a pretty good gravel road, but it turned into a dirt road. And we just started going up these hollows and over ridges and way back in Hartsville County, Idaho. Didn't even know it existed. And finally that dirt road just kind of petered out into two wheel ruts going through the woods. And I mean, the high weeds were scraping up under the car, and the branches from the trees were closing in, scraping the side of the car. And finally that just stopped, and we drove through a little creek into the moonshiner's front car. And as soon as we turned out off the engine of the car, every breed of dog and running out and surrounded, growling and barking, surrounded our car. And then the moonshiner himself stepped out of the front door of the cabin just stood there looking at us, very, very suspicious. And I remember he was probably in his 40s, but he looked in his 60s. He had lived hard. And he had his overalls, just had this real wiry frame, so his overalls just hung on loose, and these big working boots, and just looked like a character of a hillbilly. And I remember his eyes, just those steel gray eyes looking out from under that old greasy ball cap that he had on, just looking hard. And then he recognized us, and his face brightened up, and he called the dogs off, and he said, "Get that mash, come on, follow me." So we got out of the car, and I was carrying the mash, and we went around behind this cabin and started up the mountain behind this cabin. And we were going up through the woods, and to the left of us as we went up the mountain was this huge, huge mountain laurel patch. Now, you all probably have rhododendron around here, but in the mountains, it's a cousin to the rhododendron, is laurel. And it can grow, it can just cover acres. And it's so entangled, it's so close that you literally have to get down on your hands and knees to get through it. So we were walking up along beside the edge of this laurel patch, and all of a sudden the moonshiner just turned and disappeared into the laurel patch. I'm like, I've got this crock full of mass, I can't carry it through the laurel. But when we got up to where he disappeared, we saw that it was this ingeniously hidden secret path. And if you went through the first few branches of the laurel, it kind of opened up, and there was this path that wound through the laurel like a maze. And so we walked along that. It was just ingeniously hidden. You'd never see it unless you knew exactly where you were. And so we walked through this laurel, cutting back, wandering around for a couple of hundred yards. And then it opened up into the most beautiful little meadow I've ever seen in my life. Just this little grassy spot in the middle of the woods, and it was surrounded by old growth trees on one side, and laurel thicket on the other, and it had a little mountain stream running right through the middle of it. Just beautiful. And there in the middle of that meadow was a little fire ring where you could build a fire, and on a locked shelf like that there was my little Pentagon still sitting. And so the moonshiner told us to go ahead and put the mash in the still, and he would get the fire going. And making moonshine is not that complicated a process. It's really not. Y'all used to talk about that stuff like this. You used to have an education course to do as well. So making moonshine, basically, you burn in this corn mixture, you put it in the still, and because alcohol will turn to steam before water will, you just control your fire so that alcohol burns to steam and then it comes up, condenses, turns back into liquid as it goes down the coil, and you just set a jug or something under the bottom of the coil, and it comes out as your moonshine. However, there's a real art to doing all of these things, as simple as it seems, and I'm telling you, good moonshine made by somebody that really knows what they're doing, it is better than anything you can get at the liquor store. I promise you, it's smooth, it is good. But if you don't make it right, it can kill you. So you have to be careful about who's making the moonshine. So the moonshine has kind of conducted all of this. He's got the fire on, and the evening's coming on. You know, the crickets are starting to chirp, and somewhere deep in the woods, you can hear the whippoorwill start to sing. It's just this wonderful kind of coming of age experience for me. I'm out there with my dad, this moonshiner is telling these old stories, and you know, I'm becoming a man in this situation. And we're sitting there, and it's just so wonderful and so purely mountain in so many ways. And then we hear a stick crack. And we hear footsteps starting to come down that laurel path toward us. Well, I don't need to remind you all that what we're doing is highly illegal. You know, my poor dad, is just a businessman in this town. He could go to jail. The moonshiner could definitely go to jail. All my plans of going to college could go right down the drain. If this is the sheriff coming, we are in trouble. And I realized how brave our troll was when I saw that old moonshine slip his hand inside the bib of his overalls and just kind of rest there on something that I had noticed was bulging a little bit earlier. So I knew this was serious business. We weren't playing around with this. So his footsteps were getting closer and closer. And I was getting more and more scared every second. And then the moonshiner's wife stepped out. And we all breathed this huge sigh of relief. And she had come out and she had brought a guitar. And Dad had asked me to bring my banjo. And so we sat around and started playing. And she, being just an old mountain woman that had grown up with all the old songs, all the old ballads that had been passed down for hundreds of years. And so we were just playing those and just enjoying the night. She had this pure mountain voice that was so beautiful, so honest. And then she started playing this song. And it was soft at first, but then it got stronger. As she sung, one glad morning, when this life is over, I'll be
sing a line of the hymn, and then
the congregation would sing that back. It was a kind of a call and response sort of thing. So they didn't have to remember the words. They would have somebody to say the words, and then they would sing them. And what happened in time was, because everybody knew the tunes, maybe not the words, but the tunes to these hymns, it gave the song leader some creative license with how they wanted to sing those lines. So the song leader would sing a melody that was different, maybe the rhythm was different, maybe certainly the tempo often was different from the song itself, but then the congregation would sing the traditional melody at the traditional tempo and rhythm back to it. Does that make sense? So what the leader actually sang, given the words, may not sound exactly much more than vaguely like the hymn, but the congregation would sing it back the way that we ought to do it. So I want to try that with Amazing Grace, because I know you all know Amazing Grace. But I will give you a little taste of how this works. So I'll sing a line, and then you all sing back, not what I sing, but what you know as the hymn. Okay? Everybody got that? So, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound.
We believe.
believe that Christ's work of reconciliation is made manifest in the church as a community of believers who have been reconciled with God and with one another. That unity is, therefore, both a gift and an obligation for the Church of Jesus Christ. That through the working of God's Spirit, it is a binding force, yet simultaneously a reality which must be earnestly pursued and sought. One which the people of God must continually be built up to attain. That this unity must become visible so that the world may believe that separation and enmity and hatred between people and groups is sin, which Christ has already conquered, and accordingly that anything which threatens this unity may have no place in the church and must be resisted. That this unity of the people of God must be manifested and be active in a variety of ways in which we love one another, that we experience, practice, and pursue community with one another, that we are obligated to give ourselves willingly and joyfully to be of benefit and blessing to one another, that we share one faith, have one calling, are of one soul and one mind, have one God and Father, are fulfilled with one Spirit, are baptized with one baptism, eat of one bread and drink of one cup, confess one name, are obedient to one Lord, work for one cause, and share one hope. Together come to know the height and the breadth and the depth of the love of Christ. Together are built up to the stature of Christ, to the new humanity. Together know and bear one another's burdens, thereby fulfilling the law of Christ, that we need one another and upbuild one another, admonishing and comforting one another, that we suffer with one another for the sake of righteousness. Pray together, together serve God in this world, and together fight against all which may threaten or hinder this unity. Lord, let our congregation be a witness to you, immersed in Scripture, constant in prayer, joyful in worship, generous in giving, a loving, supportive community, reaching out to those in need. offer these gifts to support your words and ministries around the world.
Share with you Joyce and concerns from the book. This is a note from Joyce. My grandson Kenneth is improving. He is eating a little by mouth, although he still has the feeding tube. And she says, many, many thanks for all your prayers. And also, as I know some of you know, Joyce lost her mother last night. Her mother passed away last night. So please keep Joyce in your prayers, especially through these next few days. Many thanks for all the service men and women in the military for serving our country. Evelyn requests the prayers for the McKinney family, prayers for all those who are traveling through the holidays, prayers for Kim and Tom and Jesse and Rob, prayers for an end to war, for all the victims of violence and war, and for Susan's friend, Stacy Cooper. Please keep all of those in your mind, not only this morning, but as you go throughout the week. I'll share with you a prayer for veterans and those who serve in the military. Oftentimes I find the Methodist liturgy a good source for things. This particular prayer, they stole from us. So it's good ecumenical sharing with this. So let us go to God in prayer. Righteous God, you rule the nations. Guard brave men and women in military service. Give them compassion for those who confront them as enemies. Keep our children from hate that hardens or from scorekeeping with human lives. Though for a season they must be people of war, let them live for peace, as eager for agreement as for victory. Encourage them as they encourage one another, and never let hard duty separate them from loyalty to your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray the words he taught his disciples when praying to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Yeah.
gathered here are out serving Christ in the world. Don't forget that. Go with that confidence of the power of God.